Dear children, in the previous class, I have explained you the various atomic models suggested by J.J. Thomson and Rutherford. We also studied that there were drawbacks in the Rutherford model. Niels Bohr tried to improve the Rutherford model. But before taking up the Niels Bohr's model, let me tell you that what historical development helped Niels Bohr to establish his atomic model. Maxwell established that the electromagnetic radiation has a dual nature, the wave nature and the particle nature. Let's see that. Light is a type of electromagnetic energy and it has a wave nature as well as the particle nature. The particle natures are known as the photons. Let's see the electromagnetic radiation. You can see the particle nature and the wave nature. Electromagnetic spectrum you can see on the slide. There are many regions in the electromagnetic radiation. They are known by different names. They all differ in the wavelength and the frequencies. The ultraviolet light, infrared, the radio waves, the visible region. Our eyes can only detect the visible region. All other are invisible to the human eyes. To detect these invisible region, we need special instruments. You can see the very small portion in the electromagnetic radiation, which is known as the visible region. And you can also see the spectrum of the visible region. When a white light is passed through the prism, it disperses into 7 colors, that is vibgyor. Wavelength and frequency are related as lambda into nu is equals to c, and it is equals to 3 into 10 raised to power 8 meter per second. Frequency or wavelength determines the type of the radiation. This Maxwell's concept helped Bohr a lot. Bohr then gave his atomic model and he proposed that atom has a nucleus in the center and the electrons are revolving in the fixed orbits around the nucleus. These orbits have the fixed radius and energy, and they are present in the form of the concentric rings. He also suggested that when the electron is moving in the fixed orbit, there is no change in the energy. But when electron jumps from the lower energy level to the higher energy level, it absorbs energy. Or when an electron moves back from the higher energy level to the lower energy level, the energy is radiated or emitted. You can see the basic structure of an atom. Electron in an orbit and nucleus in the center. Nucleus is made up of neutrons and protons. Electron orbits. Bohr also suggested that there are certain fixed orbits. They have fixed energy and fixed radius. Here in this picture, you can very well see the concentric rings. These are Bohr orbits. Line spectra is only observed when electron jumps from the lower energy level to higher energy level or from the higher energy level to the lower energy level. Putting together the Bohr and the Rutherford model, now let's see the atomic model. In the center of an atom, a nucleus is drawn and the nucleus should have the protons and the neutrons as per the element. Then orbit is drawn around the nucleus. Here you can see the helium atom. 2 protons, 2 neutrons in the nucleus and the 2 electrons in the orbit. One more example, lithium. Atomic number of lithium is 3. That means it has 3 protons and 3 electrons. Just see its structure. In the nucleus, it has 3 protons and 4 neutrons, and there are 3 electrons. You can see that in the inner orbit, there are 2 electrons, and in the outer orbit, there is 1 electron. This picture shows you the KLMN shells in orbit. I am frequently using this word orbit. Orbits are the definite circular paths in which electrons are moving around the nucleus. This name was suggested by Bohr. An orbit proposed by Bohr is a circular path around the nucleus in which an electron moves. They have no real meaning and their existence can never be demonstrated experimentally. Dear children, but the latest concept is an orbital. Now, why this orbital? Just like the Rutherford model, there were drawbacks in that. Similarly, there were drawbacks in the Niels Bohr model. Niels Bohr model successfully explained the stability of the hydrogen atom, and definitely it was an improvement over the Rutherford model. But it failed to explain the finer details of the spectra of the hydrogen. Also, it failed to explain the Zeeman effect and the Stark effect. That is why there is a splitting in the spectral lines in the electric field and the magnetic field. Bohr model only successfully explained the hydrogen atom and its structure. It failed to explain the spectrum of the other atoms. It also failed that how atoms combine to form molecules. It was all explained by quantum mechanical model of the atom. The quantum mechanical model of an atom suggested that there is nothing like orbit. There are orbitals. Now let us know what are orbitals. These are the regions around the nucleus where chances of finding the electron is maximum. There is no definite path like orbit. The scientists, they used to explain the atomic model like a solar system. Just like the planet is moving around the sun, similarly they thought that electrons are moving around the nucleus in the definite path. But quantum mechanical model suggested, no, there is no such definite path. There are regions where we can expect the electron to be its maximum. And these regions are known as orbitals. The orbitals having the same energy are called degenerate orbitals. There are orbitals which have same energy, and they are known as degenerate orbitals. Node. There are region where chances of finding an electron is almost nil. Such regions are known as node or the nodal surface. The total number of nodes is given by n minus 1. For example, the 2s orbital, the number of nodes will be 1. Now let me tell you the shapes of the various orbitals. The s orbital. The s orbital is spherically symmetrical. That means chances of finding the electron around the nucleus is equal in all the directions. The size of the 2s orbital is larger than the 1s orbital. The same way, the size of the 3s orbital is larger than the 2s orbital. I will discuss it later when I will explain the quantum numbers. P orbital. There are 3 type of P orbitals as per their orientations along x-axis, y-axis and z-axis. The P orbitals are designated as Px, Py, Pz. The P orbitals are dumbbell-shaped. D orbitals. The d orbitals, there are 5 types. Again, there are dumbbell shaped, but there are double dumbbells. They are designated as dxy, dyz, dxz, dx square minus y square, and dz square. You can see a very clear picture of the d orbitals. In first 3 d orbitals, you can see that the dumbbells are bisecting the respective axes. But in dx square minus y square and dz square orbitals, the dumbbells are along the axis. Specifically in dz square, you can see that it is just like the p orbital, but in the center there is a donut. Here all the three p orbitals px, py and pz are represented together, and you can see the movement of electrons. Here you can see the orbits and the orbitals. Dear children, till now we have studied the dual nature of the electromagnetic radiations, the electromagnetic spectrum, and how it helped the Niels Bohr to establish its model of an atom and the shapes of the various orbitals. In the next chapter, we will study about the quantum numbers and the electronic configuration.